you very much. Assalamu alaikum. Can we turn the lights back on, please? So, let's begin with a smile first. Can everybody give me a smile? Thank you. Yes, thank you. I saw that. Thank you. There's another reason for this smile, which we'll talk about a little later. But first, again, assalamu alaikum. Thank you so much. I am deeply, deeply honored. I want to thank, of course, HR Legends for this wonderful opportunity. This is the second opportunity, actually, that they have given me. And being able to deliver my passion, being able to connect with you people is just such an honor. So thank you so much. I know that most of you are here from Lahore, but I met somebody who was here from Multan also. Can you raise your hand, please? Where are you? There. Perfect. Is there anybody else that's not from Lahore? Faisalabad. Wow. Faisalabad. Where are you from? Faisalabad, wow. Thank you so much. I am so deeply honored. I just wanted to acknowledge you guys, all of you. For some of you, you have spent whatever amount you have spent in being here. For some of you, it's a small amount. For some of you, it may not be that small. But the biggest investment, I think, is the investment of time which you have made. And for that, I'm, again, so honored, so grateful. I will do my best to deliver whatever it is that you came here to speak. So the reason why I have this phone in my hand is because I would like to now request, if you can all please turn your phone off or on silent, that would be great, because meri apni soch itni achhi nahi hai, main bahut jaldi distract ho jati hu. So it would be very, very wonderful. I'd be grateful if you can turn those off. So a couple of ground rules that I would like to mention before we begin. I love feedback. I love questions. That's what gets me going. That's what I'm here for. There are two types of forums typically, a discussion forum or a kind of like what we have today, which is a talk. So if we can set a couple of boundaries, I think that would be in the interest of everybody, especially, you know, respecting the time of people that have come so far to receive a certain type of information. And I have a lot of material to cover. So if we can keep the comments and questions only when asked, I will definitely reserve a certain period of time. I think 8 o'clock is when I will open it up for general questions. And of course, I'll stay back as long as I need to answer individual questions if needed. In the middle of the talk, I would be very grateful if there are no interruptions, because like I said, mera dimag bahut jaldi distract hota hai. I'm highly ADD, so I lose track of thought very, very quickly. So are we good with that? Is everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
Wonderful, thank you. So, I want to start today's talk with a story. I love stories. I think most of you here like stories. You like stories? Okay, wonderful. So, I think you will like this story. As most stories go, this story has a lot of drama also, which I think a lot of people like as well. So, this story involves a few characters. The main character is that of a woman. The starting scene is that of a courtroom in Dallas, Texas, in USA. This woman is in court. She's sitting in the witness box. Hopefully, aap mein se kisi ko bhi courtroom ke andar ka experience nahi hua hoga. Hopefully. In any way, as a victim or as a perpetrator.
Not in Dallas.
Not in Dallas, at least. But you've probably seen movies, Hollywood movies, whatever, where you can see what the courtroom looks like. And I can tell you, it's a pretty formidable place. It's very intimidating. They're pretty large rooms, and it's mostly beautiful wood. You can actually smell wood. And typically, the way courtroom is set out is that you have, of course, the witness box and then the bench where the judge sits. So in this story, the woman is in the witness box. In front of her is the jury. The audience and the attorneys are on this side. And here is the judge. The judge's bench typically sits a little bit high. It's all wood, mahogany or teak. And when the judge, you know, Texas men are typically large to begin with. They're big men. But this judge in particular was even bigger looking, perhaps, because he was sitting higher up. He's wearing his black robes. He's got a very stern, serious expression on his face. And his glasses make him look even more serious. They are very scary people, these judges, I can tell you. This woman sitting in the witness box looks at the judge, She feels the complete weight of the American justice system in the form of that judge. The judge looks even more formidable to her today than ever before because she remembers the experiences she has had in his courtroom before. Before the court, during the informal hearings, she had been there before. And every time, she had been humiliated and she had left the courtroom crying, typically. So she sits here today in the witness box facing the opposing attorney. His name is Greg Finley. Finley is one of the most scary attorneys in Dallas, probably in whole of Texas. He's known as a bulldog. That is his nickname. Some people also call him a tough nut. He has earned those nicknames because he is exactly that. When Greg Finley takes a case, he has one and only one goal, and that is to destroy. That is to destroy his opponent, be it the attorneys or the attorney's client. He will do everything and anything in the book. He will play dirty if he has to. And he does. And she has experienced that with Greg. She knows how dirty he can get. He's merciless. His only goal is to win. She's also feeling a lot of anxiety. By this time, her heart is beginning to beat very hard. It almost sounds as if the whole courtroom can hear the thudding of her heart. And yet, it's only her heart, so she knows it's just her. Perhaps part of the reason why she's feeling so anxious is because she knows that months of trying and trial and training and preparation went into this day of this trial. And everything hinges on the next few moments. What's going to happen between Finley and this woman is going to decide how this case is going to be decided, how it's going to finish. And there has been a critical piece on which everything hinges, an affidavit which she signed, which she knows Finley is going to use against her to prove that she is either a liar or somebody who's imbalanced, indecisive. She knows that today Finley has to prove either one, either that she's indecisive or that she's a liar, and he will win his case. And if he proves both, then it's hands down a victory for him. That affidavit is going to actually prove one or both of these things, because she signed it. So she sees him approaching her. Finley is feeling very confident. He is, of course, who he is. In Texas, they call him badass. He is that. He has beaten any attorney that has come up in front of him. He has earned the name of Bulldog. He has destroyed other attorneys on the stand in front of the judges. And this woman is a housewife. He has made her cry several times before, just by putting her under a little bit of pressure. She broke every single time. He knows it's going to be so easy to handle her. He also knows he has that affidavit, and he's going to be able to use that and break her down very easily. So as he approaches her, he shows that affidavit to her, knowing that that's going to make her cringe inside. Everybody's watching. The district attorney is also watching, knowing what that affidavit means. His months of preparation and work now hinges on what's going to happen in the next few minutes. What Finley doesn't realize, though, is that that woman sitting in front of him is not the same woman that he had dealt with before. You see, the terror, the sheer terror that she felt right before coming that day to court made her really go deep inside and examine what in the world was going to happen. There were a few facts that she could not deny. She had signed the affidavit. What the affidavit said was going to come out in the courtroom. The only thing she knew that she could do today was to remain authentic and somehow remain calm, because every time she had cried in front of the judge before that, stating her case, stating the truth, it had not helped. Because even though what she was telling was the truth, the judge had not cared. So she knew that in order to somehow get her message across to the jury, she had to stay balanced, she had to stay calm. That was the one thing she knew that day. The rest she didn't know. She didn't know what was gonna happen, how it was gonna happen. She had faith that if she just stayed calm, she will somehow figure it out. So Finley approaches her with his bravado, you know. He's full of action, he knows what's gonna happen. The judge looks at his watch and says, "Mr. Finley, do you think we should break for lunch?" And he goes, "No, Your Honor, this will be over in a few minutes." Everybody in the courtroom knows what that means. He approaches her, hands her the affidavit. She takes it. He then goes, "Ma'am, can you please look at this document and see if you recognize it?" She says, "Yes." She looks at it. "Yes, I recognize it." And he says, "Okay, can you please read it and then go to the last page and look at the end, at the signature, at the bottom of the affidavit. Do you recognize the signature?" "Yes, I recognize the signature." And he says, "Can you please tell this court whose signature is this?" She says, "It's mine." And then Finley looks at everybody, smiles, and he goes, "Now, ma'am, can you please read this affidavit?" In summary, the affidavit basically just said, stated her name, you know, "I so-and-so hereby solemnly swear that I am under no duress and I am taking this decision on my own, and I am asking the state of Texas not to prosecute this man, my husband, for assault and battery, for domestic violence." In that second, as she's reading that affidavit, the whole thing goes through her mind. The months that had led up to that moment, her marriage, the abuse, the divorce, the case, dealing with this attorney, realizing that for most people, this just looked like a divorce case. For her, it was more important than life, because what hung in balance was not just winning or losing a divorce case, it was the custody of something that was more precious to her than her own life, her daughters. She knew what was at stake. It was more than her life. And yet she had signed that affidavit, saying she didn't want the state of Texas to prosecute that man, when everything in her body wanted that man to pay for the abuse, that man to acknowledge and to just say sorry for what he had done. If she lost the case, she would not just lose the custody, she would lose what she stood for. She knew all of that. And yet, all Finley had to do was just prove her either indecisive or a liar, and the jury would side in the favor of the perpetrator. So yes, she acknowledged, "Yes, this is my signature." And when she read the affidavit, Finley turned to the court, incredulous, like, "Okay, so here's an affidavit that you signed under oath, and you said you didn't want this man to be prosecuted. Did you change your mind, ma'am?" That was a loaded question. She said, "No, I have not changed my mind." Again, he turned to the jury. "What is she talking about? The affidavit says she doesn't want him prosecuted. Here, under oath, she's saying she wants him prosecuted, and yet she's saying she didn't change her mind." He had her. Either she's a liar or she doesn't know what she wants. Everybody in the court knew what that meant. So he asked her again. He goes, "Ma'am, what do you mean? I'm confused. Did you not change your mind?" She said, "No. No, sir, I never changed my mind. This is what I want. I want him prosecuted." Boom. This was it. He went in for the kill. Now he can prove her a liar. He said, you signed that affidavit under oath, and now you're saying under oath something very different. That means you're a liar. Again, she stayed calm, looked at him, simply said, no, sir, I'm not a liar. That was new for Finley. By this time, he was expecting her to show some nerves or get jittery or something. He put more pressure on her, did some more drama, walked around, pulled all kinds of things, like, either, ma'am, you are confused, you said this, and now you're saying this, and now you're... Which one is it? Again, she just stayed calm, just didn't say anything until he asked her, and then she would give just two short words. Either, I'm not a liar, or no, I have not changed her mind. He finally began to get exasperated. He wasn't getting anywhere. So he finally just said, can you please tell the court what you mean? And that was the opening that she was looking for, because now she was allowed to speak whatever was in her mind, irrespective of the court laws. And so she went in and she said, Mr. Finley, I never changed my mind. I wanted him prosecuted, but you were not allowing me my divorce. All my money was tied up in the divorce. I had two daughters. I did not have any money to feed them. I did what anybody in my position would do. I signed an affidavit because I needed the money to pay for bills and for my children. I had no money. What would you do, sir? Everything was changed. The whole air in the courtroom changed. The case was over. Finley pulled his hair out knowing, oh my God, all lawyers are taught this one thing, never ask a question that you don't already know an answer to. They all know this, and yet he had lost control of his emotions and asked a question that gave her the opening to spill out the fact which she was otherwise not allowed to talk about. She looked at the jurors. Every single juror had empathy in their eyes, like I see in your eyes right now. Everybody can relate to that woman's position. They knew what had happened. They knew that she had told a small white lie, of course, in signing that affidavit. But guess what? They didn't care. They didn't care because they could relate. They could also see that this woman was in balance and she was not emotional. She was somebody wise. She was smart. They could feel sympathy and empathy for her. Long story short, the case was over after that.
And she won. You like that story? Like that story?
Congratulations.
Thanks. Yes, you guessed it. It's a true story. It's my story. It was in 2009. That was the beginning of my journey into learning about emotional intelligence. What does that mean? Because you see, you can be telling the biggest truth in front of the best judge, but unless you know how to present yourself in a balanced manner, it's not going to have an effect. This is true for everything in life. That started my journey. I want to share a little bit about what I was going through at that time. 2009 was what you would call the dark night of my soul. I had lost everything, my business, my career of 15 years, my marriage, my social life, all my friends were gone. It was truly one of the lowest points in my life. And this court case was the icing on the cake. Because to be in a court case in America without having legal representation is akin to suicide, really. But nobody was willing to take my case because of that bulldog, Finley. They were scared of him. And yet I was able to beat him without any attorney present. It had never happened.